baseball. In today's game, we live for the monstrous blasts and the moonshots that leave us wondering if the ball will even stay in the stadium. It seems the days of appreciating the small ball aspect of the game are lost. But believe it or not, games can still be won without the ball leaving the stadium. Today's game values the run as the most important statistic. What should be considered the most important is the production of the run. A run is produced by getting a guy on base, getting him over, and getting him in. It's the getting him over part that's being forgotten. The bunt is simply devalued today. It can be detrimental to a power hitter's ego, or sometimes even seen as giving up an out. This is the lost art of bunting. In 2015, the Pittsburgh Pirates lost the division to the St. Louis Cardinals by 2 games. They lost 64 games total that year, and 15 of those losses came by 1 run. Several of those 1-run losses could have turned into wins with the utilization of a bunt. In digging through the play-by-plays of those 1-run losses, there are definitely many bunting situations passed up by the Pirates in which they failed to score that runner that they could have moved into scoring position by bunting. Let's take a look at a perfect example. It was the Pirates at the Reds April 9, 2015, a game in which the Pirates would lose 2-3. In the top of the fourth inning, Gregory Polanco hit a leadoff single. This presented a clear bunting situation for the Pirates' best player, Andrew McCutchen. Instead, he popped out to second. The next two hitters failed to bring that runner across the plate. The Pirates let a leadoff single go to waste. The situation may have been different had McCutchen moved that runner to second. Fast forward to the top of the seventh inning. Tony Sanchez walked to open up the inning, presenting another obvious bunting situation for the Pirates. Andrew Lambeau instead lined out to right. The next batter up, Josh Harrison, grounded into a double play. Once again, a leadoff base runner went to waste. Now some may feel that this is overthinking or overanalyzing, but is it? Had they successfully bunted a few more times throughout the season, they could have won 3 more games, meaning that they win the division and finish the season with the best record in baseball. At that point, they have home field advantage throughout the playoffs, rather than play a one-and-done wildcard game against the Cubs, which they lost. By bunting the baseball more often to simply move runners into scoring position, the Pittsburgh Pirates would have automatically played deeper into the playoffs and given themselves a better opportunity to win a World Series. Now, there is also a psychology about baseball that needs to be understood, and this includes bunting. Here's a prime example. Jacoby Ellsbury was seemingly helpless through the first half of September in 2015. It was September 15th, and he was 0 for his last 20 at-bats. He stepped up to the plate in the top of the ninth with a chance to turn it all around, with a bunt. There was a runner on first with nobody out, and the Yankees were down 1-0. If there was ever a perfect bunting situation, this was it. Of course, a bunt moves the tying run into scoring position, but it perhaps does even more for Jacoby Ellsbury. By laying down a successful bunt, he contributes something to his team and gets to be greeted by high fives for a job well done as he enters the dugout. This simple sacrifice could change his psyche and potentially break him out of his slump. The Yankees let him hit away. The worst possible thing happens as he grounds into a double play. His hitless streak is extended, and he walks a lonely path into the dugout wondering what he has to do to turn it all around. The Yankees would go on to win the game, but their leadoff hitter's struggles would continue. He would go hitless in the next game as well, extending his hitless streak to 25. However, in that game, he happened to lay down a bunt that moved 2 runners into scoring position. His first at-bat the following day, a leadoff single. Now, this is not to say that he had to bunt to end his hitless streak. Hitters have to hit in order to gain their confidence back. But sometimes, doing something as simple as bunting is all it takes to change momentum. These are 2 perfect examples, but let's take a look at the bunt on an even larger scale. Let's look at the number of times a team had a runner on first with no outs, a clear bunting situation. Let's say they bunt every single time and are successful 50% of the time, which I believe is extremely low, considering we're talking about the most gifted ball players in the world. Then, multiplying that number by the team's average with a runner on second base gives us the runs produced by that bunt. By this formula, the Pirates would have produced 54 runs from bunting with a runner on first and no outs, with only a 50% success rate. If they bunt successfully 80% of the time, their runs produced jumps up to 86. At that point, I'd say it's a good bet that they win 3 out of those 15 one-run losses. This run total does not even account for bunting situations with a runner on second or runners on first and second. Don't think it makes a difference? The Pirates' average with a runner on second base is .243. With a runner on third, .382. So why is it that managers and teams everywhere are staying away from the bunt? That's beyond me. There were exactly 1,200 sacrifice bunts in the MLB in 2015. In 2005, there were 1,620. Just for fun, here's something to think about. In 2015, teams averaged 688 runs for the season. In 2005, they averaged 744. I'll leave that research up to you. No matter how you look at it, baseball has and always will be about getting them on, getting them over, and getting them in.